Our presenters are Rashmi Vittal, VP of Product Marketing here at Gigya, and Joe Stanhope, Vice President and Principal Analyst at Forrester. With that, I'll hand this over to Rashmi, and she can get us started. Take it away.
Great. Thanks, Caitlin. And in fact, welcome, everybody. Thank you for joining us this morning. And in fact, actually, Joe, you're going to kick us off here and get us rolling. So, Joe, I'll hand it over to you.
Thank you. I appreciate it. It's great to be here. And of course, I would also like to thank everyone for taking time out of their very busy schedules to spend a few minutes with us talking about contextual marketing and customer identity. It's an important topic, and we're excited to share more information with you today. So a few years ago, Forrester published a concept called the Age of the Customer. And this concept was intended to demarcate a new age of business, a new epoch in business history that would be different from, say, the age of information or the industrial age. And what it was really meant to depict and define was that fundamentally, customers play a different role in business today. That historically, brands and businesses have controlled customer relationships. They determined who they communicated with, what they told their customers, where they told their customers, how they did their marketing, and how they interacted. And because of modern technology and even cultural shifts, the tables have fundamentally turned. And in 2017, in the 2010s, customers are in charge of the relationships that they have with brands. And that has a fundamental effect on, of course, corporate strategies, corporate technology, and of course, how customer interaction and customer engagement works today. And it's affected companies of every industry and every part of the world. And one of the net effects of that has been that consumers are very empowered today. They have so much information at their fingertips, right? Many times through, for example, our mobile phones, which are basically little supercomputers right in our pockets. But beyond just being empowered and being able to communicate with one another and gather incredible amounts of information or shop or be social and communicate, these devices and this age of the customer has resulted really in consumers being very entitled. We have extraordinarily high expectations for the companies that we do business with. And I would ask you to reflect upon your own relationships with brands and how you conduct yourself as a consumer in the world today. You basically expect brands to be omniscient in how they deal with you. So we've developed these incredible expectations. We expect that we can get what we want in our immediate context, in our exact moment of need. And I think if we're being honest with ourselves, when we don't get that, we feel disappointed. And that's really how modern customer relationships work between brands and consumers. Now, the key for brands for winning, for excelling, for crafting great customer relationships in this age of the customer is harnessing customer context. It's the key to understanding a customer, knowing what they need, helping craft an engagement and a set of customer experiences for them that create mutual benefit. So we break down context in three different ways at Forrester, three forms of context. The first form of context is what we call a unique profile. It's what you know about a customer. It's their name, their location, what they might have bought from you. The second is your relationship history. How have you marketed to them? What do they consume? Where are they in a customer life cycle? And finally, situational context. And this is where many Forrester clients are actively developing today after they've made good progress in relationship history and understanding customer profiles. And situational context is not just understanding what device perhaps somebody is using when they interact with you. It's really understanding what's going on with that individual and where that individual is. Where are they contacting you from? What's going on there? Where are they in their product life cycle with you? What other information about how they're using devices, what behavioral attributes are happening at this moment that help you decipher the right way to interact with that customer, the right message? Is it time to promote something to them? What's the right medium to communicate with them in? And this is really powerful for creating essentially an understanding of the precise moment that your customer is in. And when you have access to context, it really changes the conversation and it can change the way marketers work. Today, we tend to be, as marketers, very internally focused and marketer-driven. We tend to think in terms of the left side of this figure here. We use marketer words to describe our work. We think in terms of campaigns and targeting and media and campaigns and CPMs and pricing. And these are all very traditional marketing concepts, and it's how we get our work done. But if we can understand context, we can change that conversation. We can actually be very customer driven, and we can think of the world and the way we interact with our customers in terms of their needs and their moments. We can look at the world in terms of engagement, how we create a mutual exchange of value between that customer and the brand, creating utility, taking friction out of experiences, making sure the brand values are being upheld. We even measure ourselves differently. We look at things in terms of, rather than say pure cost or operational metrics, we think about engagement and the quality of that engagement. So it's a real opportunity not only to create moments when you understand context, but to rethink the way you operate as a marketer. Now, the key to mastering context is not just collecting a lot of data, and certainly that is a big part of it. It's data-driven, requires a lot of information in a very timely and effective manner to drive those insights and drive that kind of contextual engagement. But we need a foundational capability. We need the ability to bind all that data together in the right way. And so immediately what we realize with identity is that it becomes the connective tissue for contextual marketing. We can't connect all this information together. We can't build a profile. We can't understand situational context. We can't fully bind together a relationship history with a customer unless we can identify them. So identity becomes extremely critical as a success factor for marketers in the age of the customer. If we have identity, we have a huge amount of power and capability. We can start coordinating customer experiences across channels, across devices, across touch points. We can start developing deeper customer insights based on a broader and more powerful view of what our customers are doing across those contextual angles. And finally, it even helps us at an operational level with data governance. How do we manage information efficiently? How do we direct information? How do we uphold the preferences of our customers and meet their trust expectations for us? And for all of these reasons, I believe, and Forrester believes, that identity resolution is a strategic imperative for brands. It's a fundamental assumption that every marketer takes into their day-to-day work, that everything they do is based on the idea that the customer is addressable at some point down the line. And that's relying on identity. If our ability to target customers, to personalize for customers, to engage with customers, to understand our customers is all based on identity, then fundamentally identity resolution is probably the most strategic capability that marketers can develop to create great customer relationships. This is such an important concept, actually, that Forrester has placed it in its top five marketing technology capabilities for brands. We've done a lot of work on understanding the marketing technology stack at Forrester, and what we've been trying to do is work with brands to help them understand the strategic outcomes of marketing technology investments. And we believe there are five core components of delivery that a marketing technology stack has to provide to a brand so that they can move the needle. And customer identity resolution is one of those top five. It's truly a critical capability that you need to think about in advance, that you need to plan for, and that becomes critical to your success. Now, historically, identity has been very siloed, and it has been challenging to do. If it wasn't challenging, we probably wouldn't be all on the phone today talking about this. So it is important, but certainly we're not saying that it's necessarily easy. There have historically, and in many ways continue to be, certain obstacles that make this difficult. Now, that does create opportunity because we believe that the brands that work through these obstacles will put themselves in a position to develop sustainable competitive differentiation. But it does require forethought to consider how you're going to work through some of these historical challenges. The first historical challenge to great identity resolution, one, has been a sense of what I would call balance. Many times marketers are asked to choose when they are trying to identify and marry up customer information if they want to have accuracy or scale. And they're forced to make a black or white choice in that matter. It's great, of course, to have pure accuracy. Sometimes we talk about deterministic matching approaches to literally match like for like data together. And this is every marketer's dream, to have a complete set of data and accurate data about all of their customers, so we can be very granular and very specific. And again, meet our customers' expectations for contextual marketing. But that's not always possible. We don't always have all the data. Some channels don't have as much information as others. So we're sometimes forced to reach scale through other means so that we can have enough data, enough records to really execute our marketing capabilities. And you'll hear about terms like probabilistic matching that use data science to marry up with somewhat less precision, but more matching, more records, so that you can get to enough data to actually execute larger scale campaigns. But there are downsides to this too. Reaching scale is great, but without that accuracy, you have to be more careful about how granularly you use that data and how specifically you use it with your customers. The second big challenge has been the matter of entropy. One of the great things about it being a marketer today is we have so many different ways to interact and communicate with customers. It's really exciting, and any great marketer loves getting access to new touch points and devices because it fundamentally creates a new opportunity to engage with your customers. And it's even more exciting in the age of the customer because consumers are taking control and they are being proactive and they're reaching out to you. And that is also a great opportunity for marketers. But this also creates challenges because every campaign, every device, every customer, every interaction creates a new set of identifiers. And that creates a challenge in terms of volume of identification, velocity of identification, and sheer amount of data that we have to match together. And it's not just that there's a lot of it or that it's coming at you very quickly, but matching this data together is hard because we're talking about different kinds of identifiers. Different identifiers in the marketing mix today might have different levels of resolution, like individual or household. Some of them might be very public type identifiers. Some of them might be very private and have lots of privacy requirements around them. And some of them might not even be about people at all. Some of them might represent devices, for example, or just a browser. So we have many different kinds of identifiers that we're trying to bind together very quickly to understand our customer. And this increasingly becomes challenging. The third challenge is the issue of portability. When we're identifying our customers, we want to extend that understanding across our many data repositories, our many channels, devices, maybe business units and divisions at your company. We want to fully leverage that sense of identity. And in the marketing technology world, we have access to many, many tools. It's not uncommon for firms to use 10, 20, 30, even 100 different marketing technology tools and have fragments of customer identity and fragments of customer profiles broken up across all of these different tools. At Forrester, we track no fewer than 25 different advertising and marketing technologies that our clients commonly use all of. And each one of those tools has a little slice of your understanding of the customer. Now, that's great to have all that data, but again, pulling that data together is very difficult. A lot of these tools were not necessarily designed to create a single view of a customer or to let that data out into a system that can help you do that. So many brands struggle to get the data out of those source systems and bring it together to create a single view of that customer.
And I'd like to add to that, Joe. I mean, I think there's a fourth challenge here that typically goes undiscussed, and I'd like to surface it here today. Contextual marketing is key. It's actually building a two-way, in order to do contextual marketing right, you really need to build a trusted two-way relationship between the brand and the customer. And one of the key challenges that we're seeing is that trust is actually broken today. A lot of the times you might have a lot of data that you're capturing, you're really driving towards with the best intentions of doing personalization, but sometimes you could take that data and cross that creepy line. In fact, we not only ourselves that we're seeing this, we've conducted research recently that indicates this, but also we're seeing this trend happening and research kind of suggesting as much that customers are losing trust with brands. And it's predominant because they just don't trust the way brands are handling their personal information. To kind of support that even further, there's a recent research by Accenture that actually compared and took a look at what is a consumer's relationship with a brand and how that brand is using that data. And it really boils down to two core concepts. Trust is really built around, one, being fully transparent And the other one is for consumers to be able to feel like they have control over how their data is used. So, you know, in this research, it actually suggested that 70% of consumers said that they would feel comfortable sharing their personal data if they knew how their data is used. That's totally talking to transparency. And even more so, 75% said that they feel comfortable in the way that their data should be used if they had more control over how it's used. So I think part of this other aspect of when you're thinking about identity and thinking about how you continue to drive contextual marketing, building trust is one of those key initiatives. And so as we kind of move through those challenges, I think the next thing is kind of to the point of what is it that you actually need? And so, Joe, how do you think about defining identity resolution? What are some of the core tenets for solving some of these challenges?
Yeah, I think that's a perfect point and transition, because I think we have to think about identity a little bit differently than we have historically. I think at Forrester, what we've tried to do, and we intentionally picked the semantics around identity resolution, because literally what we wanted to indicate was that identity resolution is more than just pure identity. One of the risks of merely looking at the world in terms of, look, we're going to marry up a bunch of keys in a database, is that it becomes shelfware. It doesn't actually do anything or help marketers or help the enterprise. It's merely an object. And what we want to do is help brands understand that there are several key factors, right, to successful identity resolution and taking it beyond, right, that simple just set of keys. So it's really an asset that they can use across their customer relationships for contextual marketing and customer engagement. And the first big concept behind identity resolution is understanding that it's not binary. I think a lot of times when we start thinking about identity, we look at it in a very black or white way. We either know who that customer is, especially from like a known customer PII perspective, or we don't, right? Maybe they're anonymous and we don't know them. And it's either on or off identity. And I think that's a mistake. I think we have to start considering that identity has a lot of variance within it. In fact, there are different degrees of identity that match up to different spots in the customer lifecycle. Just because a customer is perhaps anonymous, you know, you don't exactly know everything about them yet, doesn't mean that that information, that that sense of identity that you do have about them is not useful or valuable, right? You have to look at, in a sense, each level of identity in context of where they are in that customer lifecycle and what's appropriate at that stage. And you also look at it as a long-term play where we're building a profile and a sense of identity around a consumer over time as they work through the lifecycle stages of developing a relationship with your brand. And so what actually happens is that we see that identity actually lives on a spectrum, right? It's not on or off or black and white. It's just different levels of identity. And what you have to think about is what level of identity do we need for how we want to interact with our customers? We don't have to pursue necessarily the perfect, most complete golden record. You only need as much identity as you need to achieve the level of insights you want about your customers or the types of engagements that you want to undertake with your customers. That's what actually determines, the use cases actually determine what level of identity you need.
Yeah, and I'm happy you mentioned that. I mean, all fantastic points, Joe. And in fact, you know, here at Gigya, we've worked with over 700 brands to deliver customer identity management to help them derive more value out of the information that they're gathering about their customer and then using that to drive more effective marketing, even drive more effective sales as well as services. One of the key things that we talk about when we talk about our customers is that you're absolutely right. Identity isn't binary. It isn't black or white. And if you think more kind of, if you think about more holistically about that customer journey, right? Think about how a customer moves along that from awareness to consideration to conversion, retention, and advocacy. It's really an opportunity to get to know that customer better. It's an opportunity to go from anonymous consumer to actually building up information about that consumer. And as I was talking about before, also delivering that kind of and building up that two-way sharing relationship between consumer and brand. And to your point, we fundamentally believe that, you know, when you think about those in that first visit to a website, that those anonymous, it's a very anonymous interactions, there's absolutely value there that you can grab that today you can do through, whether that's through a cookie ID or a mobile ad ID, and how you stitch those things together. We also believe there's another way to start building, you know, as you move down the journey, that there's another opportunity to be able to get more information from your consumers in exchange for some value that you could give to them, right? So for example, we think about some of the things called like light registration, right? How can we offer to a customer some kind of value? Maybe a customer wants to sign up for a newsletter on a website, or maybe even she's in a store and wants to be able to use her email address to sign up for a rewards program, or if the user is calling into a call center, is talking to an agent, the agent may ask the customer for an email address to receive some kind of additional information after the service call is over. Whatever that might be, there's definitely a lightweight way to start accumulating information from your customers in something that they have voluntarily provided, and then being able to provide some value to that. This doesn't require you to have to be either heavy-handed in making them do something like a complete registration at that point of interaction, but a way to just be able to get them to get a piece of content that they're looking for, in exchange getting some identification about them. And you know, here's an example of let's just say a newsletter sign up, right? Where you're just simply providing a name and an email address, and then you're going to be able to receive this newsletter, and then now you're signed up for it. You know, it's the beginning of a relationship that you're building with that customer. I'd say as you continue down that customer journey, you know, and then you eventually get to that conversion stage, whether it is an e-commerce site or you're signing up for a subscription to your favorite online publication, there's a real opportunity here to kind of present additional value to your customers in the terms of the service or good that they're paying for or purchasing. And at that point in time, being able to get more information about who that customer is. And that's traditionally known through the registration process. But not only that, is it just about providing more here, a username and password. This is really where you can now link that light account information, that email address, or that mobile phone number that you might have gotten in order to get that initial newsletter subscription with the full account. So that information about the user and their communication preference isn't lost. You're maintaining that continuity. And like, if you think about a couple of examples here, there's certainly different elements you need to consider as part of the customer experience as they're engaging with, whether it's your mobile application, whether they're engaging directly off of your website, off of a desktop browser, or whether, you know, even simply there's more of an engagement between a consumer and, let's say, an IoT device. But one of the things you have to think about is, what is that process through getting registration? You know, what is it like? How frictionless of experience can it be? Now, certainly we're all very familiar with this notion of a username and password. These are very key identifiers that you can capture. But now the next question is, well, let's say I self-identify on a website, and then later on I use that same brand's mobile application. You want to be off of your smartphone, different devices, different experiences. You want to be able to link those things together. So now you're actually stitching those identities, and then you can be able to build a profile off of that. And then once, as you move through that whole notion of the customer journey, and then now you're moving into retention, right? After conversion, you're moving into retention. There's now this notion of how can we add more attributes and profile attributes about the consumer. And there's many different ways that you can do this. But most importantly, the reason why you're doing this is fundamentally is that you can drive a better personalization experience. And so there's ways that you could do this. You may have heard technologies like progressive profiling, where over time and at the right time, you know, you ask for additional information about the consumer when you can give that consumer some form of value. And here, you know, take this example, right? You know, let's just say you have you're a repeat visitor to a website. You've purchased, you've logged in. Maybe after the third login, or triggered by some other event, like clicking on a specific product category, you know, you can now ask that user for more information about their preferences. And in this instance, it could be their favorite sports or outdoor activities. So fundamentally, if you think about, Joe, kind of what you were talking about in terms of identity is not black or white, it is more so a relationship and building the information about your consumer over the life cycle of that consumer, but doing so in a trusted way that's also delivering value to the consumer. Those are some key tenets that we think about when you're thinking about putting together an identity strategy.
Yeah, that's exactly right. The progressive nature of building identity and understanding the value of identity at the individual stage is really crucial as a way for fully leveraging the identity asset and making the most of it. The second big capability that I think about in terms of identity resolution from a definition perspective is understanding the dynamic nature of it. The fact that identity resolution never stands still. The fact is that identity information changes every second of every day, and it does not age very well. The information is always changing. And so really, it's not a one-off project. It's not just a database, for example. Identity resolution is literally a process, and it's a continuous one, and it follows multiple stages that you will constantly be cycling through. The first stage is really collecting, yes, that sense of identity, and there might be keys or identifiers that you will bring together, and of course, you're going to try to integrate those using various techniques, depending on the kind of information and the sensitivity of that data and what's appropriate. But again, identity resolution is more than identity. We have to do something with that sense of a resolved identity that we've developed, because we want to take action on it to develop contextual marketing. So the next stage is marrying identity actually with what we know about the customer, that contextual information of a profile, relationship history, situational context. And once we've married up a complete profile to a complete view of the customer, then we can really start taking action. This is when it gets interesting. We can start using that information across our interactions and engagement with the customer. We can use it for those insights. We can use it for that customer engagement. What we also have to plan for is, again, these profiles, this set of identity is always going to be changing and evolving. So initially, of course, you're going to go through that process of collection and creating links and building a profile, but it doesn't stop there. On a go-forward basis, we need to understand the processes and the mechanisms that we're going to use to handle basic management. Right? And perhaps it's not always the most exciting capability, but perhaps it's one of the most important, because this is what's going to create an accurate set of information to create relevant and engaging interactions. We're going to have to add new data. Maybe you get a new channel, adopt a new touch point. Someone gets a new device or has a new preference. Sometimes we're going to have to take data out of the system. Right? Maybe somebody opts out. Maybe they stop using a device. Maybe you get rid of or change a data supplier. So information will have to come off the system just like it has to go on. And then, of course, we have to go through basic hygiene and management processes that are very, very important. Deduplication, operating at the right levels of resolution, basic hygiene and data updates. And this ensures that we've got the right information at our fingertips. Then we're going to have to prepare to actually move that information around, make it available to those systems of insight and systems of engagement. What do we have to format that information into? How do we actually transfer it to other systems? Sometimes you're going to have to anonymize this data for certain applications that don't involve PII. And then, of course, you're actually going to use endpoints to apply that sense of identity once it's married up with your other contextual information for analysis and orchestration and delivery.
Yeah, and to that last point there, Joe, in terms of marrying up that identity for orchestration across your market, whether it's your marketing tech stack or any of your digital tech stack, you know, one of the core components too of being able to centrally store identity, and also to centrally store identity, is to then be able to enrich that identity continuously throughout that customer life cycle, but then share and synchronize that identity into downstream applications. And this is so important when you're thinking about customer advocacy, right? Because over this journey and over the life cycle of the customer, you're surely capturing a lot of rich information. And not only that, a lot of times that information can be self-volunteered information that then you have you could build a pretty prolific customer profile. And that profile should then be able to be synchronized along the other solutions that you have in place that are executing against your marketing and more importantly, your personalization strategy. So one of the other key tenets we think about is, you know, how can we take that rich customer identity? How can we take those profiles and how can we better integrate it into your email marketing solutions, or whether that's into your CRM solution, or whether that's driving kind of better personalization off of your web experience? Or even so, how do we make sure that we could now bridge between that deterministic world and that probabilistic world that's probably sitting in your technologies like your DMP and whatnot, but how can we make that DMP smarter, knowing that you have a deterministic ID that you've been managing and can link that together? And the other thing to note is that, to your point, this never stands still. This is a constant ongoing process of ensuring that your identities are syncing up across your digital technology stack, and it's not just one directional. You know, another thing that we really advocate when we're working with our customers is ensuring that the information that you're capturing within your marketing applications are also being, especially as it relates to identity and that profile data, can now be fed back into that centrally kind of identity management solution, so that you know that you are building that single view of customer, that you do have a place that can start being considered that system of record. And so, Joe, we come to the third point: identity resolution must be transparent. How do you think about this today in your conversations with your customers?
Yeah, I think this is, in a sense, an output of the previous discussion that you had around trust, right? That begets a need for transparency and, in a sense, a sense of responsibility for how we use this information. It's exciting when you embark on identity resolution enhancements because it gives marketers a tremendous opportunity, a tremendously powerful capability to understand customers, to interact with customers, to create unprecedented levels of relevant engagement. But of course, with that kind of capability comes responsibility. You have to think about what I call the usability of data. And I certainly don't want to get into a workshop on regulatory compliance here, but there are different kinds of usability of data and identity that we have to consider up front before we really start undertaking any kind of action that directly involves a customer. I break the concepts of usability down into three areas: formal, technical, and emotional. And formal usability is really what are the privacy and regulatory mandates that you as a marketer need to uphold and meet, right? Based on your industry, your geography, best practices, industry requirements that you might, and channel requirements that you're undertaking. Right, and we assume that most firms and everyone on this call, you know, you're a good actor and you've got all those things sorted out, or you're actively working on it. Technical usability is understanding how do you actually match data together, some of the actual techniques and the methods for accomplishing, developing that resolved identity and matching that up to contextual and profile data. And a good way to think about this is to actually start to initially understand what are the implications for over or under combining data. Sometimes, depending on the application, over or under combining data is not a really huge deal that might create some marketing waste. Like, for example, you retarget me on a home computer and my wife ends up seeing it, right? That's a little bit frustrating, right? Because she wasn't supposed to see a certain retargeting ad. I was supposed to see it. But it's not a crisis by any means in corporate terms or formal usability terms. But we have to understand, depending on how we use that data, what kind of matching accuracy, what kind of usability do you need there? And then you have emotional usability. And this is actually the trickiest one of all because it's really hard to predict. The watchword on emotional usability is just because you can use some data doesn't always mean that you should. I really encourage customers to get outside of their own heads and even do focus groups and try to imagine how customers will perceive your employment of data and contextual information and deeper degrees of identity. This can be very hard to predict. Consumers can be fickle. They don't always understand everything as well as you might as a marketer, or understand why something has happened. And this is why transparency is so critical, to share with them why things are happening, to be upfront, to give them the ability to indicate their preferences, and to really be in tune with how your engagements will be perceived at an emotional level by those customers.
And I really like that setup, Joe, a lot, because, you know, especially in the past year and a half or 2 years since the announcement of GDPR and the need to be able to be compliant with GDPR, it comes into effect in May 25th, 2018. We're getting a bunch of questions from our customers in terms of, you know, what is it that I need to do in terms of protecting my customer data? How do I ensure that I'm storing it correctly? How do I ensure that I'm using it and processing it in a way that aligns to that? And I think what it all fundamentally comes down to is kind of those two core tenets I was talking about again, which is really about transparency and control. And one of the key areas where you could think about transparency and control as it translates into the technologies that you're considering to put in place to handle this is around, you know, fundamentally, how do you handle consent? How are you actually capturing the consent of your, you know, of the user as they're progressing through the customer journey, as they're building a relationship with you? And I'd argue that consent, you know, may seem simple, but it's really not. It's actually quite complex. Think about, you know, you as yourself as a consumer. We're not just talking about consent management from the perspective of you know, I've registered and I've checked the little box that says I agree to your terms of services. And as you and I know, terms of services that nobody ever reads. But what consent really is if you think about it from the very beginning of the journey, from anonymous perspective, we're talking very simply about something like cookie consent, right? How are you even capturing that cookie consent in the very beginning? And then how are you linking consent to that customer profile throughout the life cycle? And one of the key, you know, when we think about managing consent and preferences of a customer, you know, we think about it in kind of four key ways. One is obviously very much so just being able to present and capture the preferences and consent at that point of interaction. So whether that's that anonymous interaction where you're capturing that cookie consent, to when you're a user might sign up for a newsletter, or they might sign up for asking to receive a promotional offer. That communication in and of itself is consent that needs to be captured, especially when you think about GDPR and kind of the evolving regulatory environments in different geographies. That's becoming increasingly important. Obviously, there's also capturing of consent at that point of registration, and we're talking about this terms of services and privacy policies. But there's also kind of some of the non-obvious types of consent that you have to capture. Like increasingly, so you need to start capturing, if you're going to use a data attribute like location to better personalize your marketing communication, you now need to be able to capture consent that you can use location data to do exactly that, right? I say the next aspect around consent and preference management is around version control. People don't think about this. They think that the interaction of version, of consent is just that first sign up. But now, especially with the evolving regulatory environment, brands today are having to update their terms of service and consent policies on a quarterly basis. So how do you start managing those different versions of consent? If you're a global brand, if you're a global company and you're operating in different geographies, there are different consent terms and policies that you have to manage within those geos. That's another layer of complexity that you have to be able to manage. So therefore, you need to be able to think about ways that how are you triggering those re-consent renewals? How are you recording that consent? And how are you tracking the history of that consent? Not only to continue to deliver on that trust value with your customer, but also to protect your own business and ensuring that you have the kind of that audit ready consent management that you can use in the event that you come under regulatory scrutiny. So if you have accurate records, then the next thing is that it can't be living in a silo. A lot of times we need to be able to ensure that those consent and preferences are now being able to be enforced into the downstream marketing, sales, and services applications that are having direct communications with your customers. So if you've opted in to receive a newsletter, you want to be able to ensure that that consent is now being managed between that centralized storage and the maybe the email service provider that's actually executing on that newsletter. If that user now opts out of the newsletter, right, through their email communication, and that ESP is now storing the fact that that consent has been opted out, that too needs to be synchronized and enforced back into that centrally managed system, such that now that if you know you have that, again, that single view of consent, you can now push that out between your email provider, your CRM system, your service call center application, whatever it might be, such that you're maintaining that consistent and enforced record. And then lastly, we've talked about this, right? We know that 75% of customers say that they're happy sharing their information if they have control over it. Both transparency and control are critical. And to deliver on that promise, you must be able to provide a way where users can view their profile and preferences and consent information. They could change it, they could update it. And they, most importantly too, they can withdraw any kind of consent, not just on those individual activities, but also how their personal data is being used. And then if you are familiar at all or thinking about GDPR and being able to be ready for it when it comes into effect, there's a whole list of individual rights around GDPR that you have to be able to provide. And that's like the right not only for the individual to be informed of any changes, the right for them to control their changes, the right for them to freeze an account, the right for them to delete an account. There's many different aspects to that now brands must be able to rely on their customers and give them the opportunity to change. And if you think about giving visibility and control, kind of breaks down into like three fundamental areas. One is around your profile and preferences, you know, and that's more, you know, around the kind of how are you managing preferences throughout the life cycle of the customer. The second part is around the legal aspect, the privacy considerations that you must be able to meet, knowing when you're able to being able to clearly show when a user has agreed to a terms of service, being able to give them the ability to opt out of how their name and personally identifiable information is being used. And then obviously their communication preferences, giving them the option to be able to state whether they want to receive that specific newsletter, and not just the activity, but against what kind of frequency, whether that's weekly, daily, monthly, and so forth. And so when I think about that, Joe, and I think about how do you take all this stuff that we talked about, right, and how do you apply it against kind of a maturity model or a process, and kind of how do you think of some of the core use cases when you're trying to describe how businesses should think about developing an identity strategy? What are some of the best practices you've seen?
Well, we advise brands to look at identity again in terms of use cases, which is essentially the outputs. Instead of thinking of it in terms of, hey, we want to have an identity, you think of it in terms of there are things that we want to accomplish in terms of customer engagement, and identity becomes a contributing foundational capability to accomplishing that. And this requires work. We're talking about a real investment of time and money and people effort to do this. And it requires, I think, thoughtful planning around how you want to apply it and building that up over time. You can't do everything literally instantly, right? This will be a longer term and dynamic effort. Most efforts in identity resolution tend to start on the very pure sort of outbound marketing side related to campaigns, what you generally call a targeting concept, right? Where we want to use a stronger sense of identity to create more contextual, more relevant, better targeted communications with customers, be it in media or other methods or channels. And that can be extremely effective, and it's a very logical place to start, right? Because you're actually directly impacting customer engagement immediately and driving, of course, marketing KPIs and performance, which is great for establishing that use case or that business case, right, and track record for an identity resolution effort. But we want to think bigger than that too, right? We want to, if you're going to go to the effort to construct an identity resolution environment, to understand that customer identity graph of customers and prospects, you need to leverage it as fully as possible, even beyond marketing, if you can, over time. So we want you to be thinking about it in terms of targeting, but also how can this effort impact your measurement, such as attribution, and how can it impact, of course, your actual personalization, right, of working with your customers. And so as you think about this roadmap, think about the maturity of those use cases that you can apply and plan to apply over time. If you build up on a maturity curve, a sense of targeting and measurement and personalization use cases, you can layer on those more and more sophisticated general maturity layers, and then add use cases within each of the three over time as well. And so we see an entire range, not just of categorical targeting, measurement, and personalization capabilities, but over time we see a set of mainstream capabilities in each of those three that many brands undertake today. And as you go further out in time, planning for some of the either more progressive or developing or emerging use cases that brands are starting to consider and that you should plan to develop over time. The other thing I want to be really clear about is that this isn't just about use cases and pure identity resolution. We tend to think of it as more of a data challenge or an operational challenge. I really also want you to focus on the processes that surround your efforts in identity resolution. And we mentioned this earlier, it's dynamic, it's always changing. You have to plan for how you're going to not only initially build, but maintain, right, this system for maximum accuracy and completeness. So also create a maturity scale and a roadmap for how you're going to master the processes that surround your use cases and your ongoing implementation and ongoing development and expansion of identity resolution efforts. So when you're just getting started, really, you can be thinking about things like, look, let's make sure we're getting the right data, we have the right suppliers, the data quality is high, and we're doing the most basic things very correctly. But as you get more mature and you're using this more broadly, you start thinking about new things, like let's actually start verifying the accuracy of our data. Let's look at the results of our campaigns that are driven by identity resolution efforts and enhanced by them, and actually verify lift and that we're getting the right kind of scale that we need to execute our campaigns. And at the most advanced levels, really, it's about creating efficiency. These are always ongoing processes, and so they're really ripe for automation. A lot of brands do struggle with the manual nature of some of these processes. It creates a real drain in terms of resourcing. So looking at how to automate the production processes with your vendors as well as internally to make identity resolution as efficient and as speedy as absolutely possible. And as we start to wind down, the way you approach identity resolution is going to be a little bit unique for every company. One company's approach to ID resolution is not necessarily the same thing that you should do at yours, but there are a few ideas that you can take away to start considering how this applies to your own firm. And to start, I would encourage you to start again at the top with the use cases. Building a set of identity for the sake of having it is not the right approach. You want to actually start with how you want to apply it and then determine which degree and types of identity are appropriate to meet those goals. Second, build that process. Think about a process from day one. How are you going to build it initially? How are you going to maintain it? And who's going to help you do that? Third, focus on data quality. Really, nothing else matters if the data is incomplete, if it is inaccurate, and if it's not driving results. Fourth, we talked about trust. We talked about usability. never lose sight of your responsibilities when you are collecting and using and applying this data. You have a fundamental responsibility, not just formally and legally, but also in the eyes of your customers, in the age of the customer, to meet their expectations. And that means that you're going to be responsible with that data. You're going to provide value for them sharing that information with you. And finally, plan for the future. This is an effort that you're going to invest in that's going to develop over time. So really build that roadmap of how do you want to apply identity resolution? How are you going to build it? How are you going to develop the processes to accomplish that?
Great. Thank you, Joe. You know, you absolutely hit the nail on the head with kind of what are the core the situation today, and we all as marketers are really trying to drive better contextual marketing, but fundamentally to be able to do that, identity needs to be at the core of that strategy. And there are definitely plenty of challenges that are there around how do you build identity, how do you build customer profiles around that identity, but hopefully based on our webinar here today, we were able to show you some kind of key considerations and some core tenets to think about as you all are evaluating your identity strategy and how you're driving better contextual marketing across your business. So with that, Joe, I thank you so much for your time. At this time, we'd like to open it up for questions. I'm going to hand it over to Caitlin. Caitlin, what questions do we have?
All right. So looks like the first one is, can cookies remain the basis by which we determine identity of our customer in the light of GDPR?
Yeah, it's a really interesting question and a good one. I would kind of like to take a step back for a second and just kind of describe what's falling under GDPR today. Absolutely, I would say before there's going to be a before GDPR and an after GDPR world. Before GDPR world, there's definitely a line that's drawn between what's considered and how you protect personally identifiable information, which is kind of that name, that first name, last name, that email, that physical address, that phone number associated to that person. And there has always been a very strict kind of privacy considerations that you have to take place when you're not only storing that data, but also using or processing that data. I think then after GDPR, getting ready for GDPR, GDPR absolutely broadens the definition of personal data. It now not only includes the PII information that I just described, but now it takes a look at what would be called like kind of indirect personal information. It's things like lifestyle and demographic information and social interest, and as well as the types of identifiers. So cookie ID, mobile ad ID now fall under the definition of personal data that needs to be stored, it needs to be managed, and it needs to be processed in adherence to GDPR. So with that being said, you know, I do think there's a hard look that has to happen at the technologies that are in place today that are handling those type of what would typically called anonymous identifiers and the way that you are using them. If you are using them to stitch together an identity and then you're marketing and then you're using that to drive marketing communications and contacting that individual, you know, you potentially could be at a risk of exposure, right? So what we talk about here is the sense that let's ensure that when you think about the areas where you can interact directly with a customer, where you can capture identity that's being self-volunteered, whether that's through a light registration process, whether that's through a full registration process, make sure that you're also taking the steps to surface the areas where you're being very transparent in how that data is going to be used, reinforce with the consumer how that data is going to be used, ask that person to be able to opt in on how that data is going to be used, and you should be kind of on that right path to getting there. And there are different, you know, I say handling GDPR, it's not just a technology solution. There's no one silver bullet. It takes people, processes, and the technology solutions together to support these evolving regulatory environments. And I think it's you going back to your organization and taking a hard look and saying, you know, do we have the right people, processes, and technologies in place to do that.
Great. Thank you, Rashmi. And there's one more question. What are some examples of companies that you feel have the most effective digital strategies incorporating identity, and why?
I can take a stab at that. This is something that a lot of companies are starting to develop a sense of recognition on and want to make enhancements to. And it's there's a lot of activity centered around this today. And where I see the most success isn't necessarily a specific company or even a specific industry. This is the interest level really is fairly universal, I would say. But again, it's the companies that really go into this saying, we want to improve specific initiatives. We want to say, look, we want to have stronger personalization capabilities for our most sophisticated and highly valued customers. We want to use identity initially to accomplish a new level of more advanced frequency management across media. We want to use identity resolution as a way to facilitate stronger cross-channel attribution. So we understand the effectiveness and the relative effectiveness of the span, right, of our marketing mix. So it's the companies that are successful are the ones that go into it with a very explicit business purpose that they want to achieve as a result of investing in this. And then the next stage of sophistication are the firms that are successful in the long term are the ones that say, we've got this roadmap for how we want to use identity resolution capabilities to expand those use cases and applications over time. And then even further out in terms of maturity and strength are the firms that look at identity resolution and that customer identity graph, if you will, as a corporate asset. And they plan to leverage that capability, not just for acquisition or customer retention or customer insights, but they plan to leverage it actually across their entire organization in customer service, for products, the contact center, even for, in banks, some of the in-store and retail applications. So looking at that asset as a tool, a foundational aspect across the entire business for all of customer experience.
Great. Thank you, Joe. We have time for just one more question. At what stage of the contextual marketing journey a company should evaluate a proper CIM platform solution?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. I'll take this one. Just for folks on the phone, just to let you know, CIM means Customer Identity and Access Management Solution. And there's a lot of the core tenets that I was reviewing here today on this call is actually supported by a CIM solution. And fundamentally, I would say, based on that whole notion of trying to build identity progressively over the customer lifecycle, you can begin with a CIM solution early in that customer journey. Even as early as the anonymous stage when you're thinking about capturing consent, even if it's cookie consent. But more importantly, I think CIM really comes into play when you're trying to engage in that value for information exchange. What kind of value can I offer in exchange for some information about the user? And certainly you can do that before they're fully registered. You can do that by offering up the newsletter. You could do that by providing a contact us form. You could do that through creating a promotional offer. You could do that even in store or on the phone with an agent, right? The key is that you're capturing that identity, right? If it's an email address or a mobile phone number, that's kind of like the gateway identifier, right, to your consumer. And you want to be able to capture that. You want to capture it along with the consent for which it was being captured. And then you want to be able to manage that throughout the customer lifecycle, so that when that user actually turns into a conversion, when they actually buy from you, when they create that account at that point of checkout, you can now link that information and build up that identity over the lifetime of that customer, so that you can start creating those rich profile attributes against that identity, and then you can use that rich customer profile against the rest of your marketing tech stack. So, my answer is as early as possible in that contextual marketing journey, especially as you think about how your customers are interacting with your websites, with your mobile applications, and if you're extending into how your customers are directly interacting with maybe some Internet of Things devices that could be part of your brand or business. Take all of these things into consideration, because that connection between user and your brand just becomes stronger.
Okay, great. Thank you very much, Rashmi and Joe, today. It was great hearing your insights into contextual marketing and customer identity. And thank you all for your questions and joining today. We will be, again, sending this recording in the next coming days, so please be on the lookout for that. And thank you all again. Have a great day.
Great. Thank you. Thanks, Joe.
Thank you.